Welcome to Killer Content Corner with Leslie and JT. And this is the Murdaugh family Killer Content Corner tonight.
That motherfuckers is ready or what? Is that motherfuckers ready or what? I don't think you are. I don't think so. They got my back against the building. I'm the villain that's creeping around corners. Like shorty, if you see them niggas creeping around corners, they might be coming through, gunning through, running through. So be careful what you do, get them slugs might come to you. As long as I can remember, the streets have kept me safe. Every since the time of December, the heat's been in my waist. I need the extra set of eyes, so I keep my dog with me. Doctor said let him die, till his fucking dog bit me. I don don't know what's wrong with me, but it seems like since you heard of us, shy niggas turned into murderers. You couldn't fuck with a third of us, but you still against me. And want to see me in the box, grilling me all crazy. When you see me in the locks, leave you fed like fox. Nothing funny about that. I see you up in the coma, it ain't coming about that. You hold on for too long, it ain't pulling the plug on you. I'm gonna open that joint myself and drop another slug on it. It's murder. It's murder.
Motherfucker, I didn't squat.
Oh, what's going on? That's good.
What's going on? It's so fitting because we're not talking about murder today. We're talking about Murdaugh.
We're trying to talk as you started off there. It's not like me. Oh yeah, that's crazy, right? How's it pronounced?
The name. Okay, so it's so strange. It's spelled M-U. R-D-A-U-G-H, Murdaugh, but the family name is, the way they are Southern, oh, you're going to hear a lot of Southern talk today. Their Southern talk is Murdaugh, and then they say Murdaugh. There's no C-K at the end, and the hierarchy of the family, or the guy who actually just went to jail, is Alex Murdaugh, and he says Alec Murdaugh. That's my name, Alec Murdaugh. Like, okay.
How do you get Doc from GH?
I don't know. Don't ask. It's a dumbass thing, but whatever. It is what it is.
It's a slang. It's their fucking slang. Southern hospitality slang.
Oh. That's a very polite way of saying it, actually. Let's talk Southern hospitality.
There you go.
Yeah. You go. This family's got everything but Southern hospitality.
Yeah, I know. I seem to be hearing about that a lot, but I've still yet to watch the YouTube version. Sorry, the Netflix version of this. Yeah. So
I think it's a 3 or 4 part episode, but here's what the thing, like, I've been following the story since the beginning. So it's about 10 years old now, or maybe a little less than 10 years old. But it's still going on. Like, it's still not complete. The story's still not done. But this Netflix special, so HBO came out with a special first, which I really enjoyed a couple years ago. And then Netflix did this special. And it's like a 4-part or 3-part. But they did it all before the trial. Now the trial's over. Right. And there's so much more coming out, and so much more has come out since that show. Right. That show is one of my references. I did watch it. But I've also been listening to there's information coming out on a daily basis regarding this whole case. I've been listening to this podcast newscast called the Murdaugh Family. Okay. And it's an actual journalist who talks about it every single day. Like, there's some, or he either gets an opinion on something, or speaks to the defense lawyers, or speaks to SLED, or speaks to, like, anything concerning this case, this journalist is covering on a day-by-day cases. So I really enjoy the podcast because, I mean, he's not biased. He's a journalist, right? And so he looks at all aspects. Like, he's interviewed the defense lawyers, he's interviewed the prosecution, you know, like he's interviewed people in town. He's interviewed other journalists that have brought evidence to life in this. So like it's a really good podcast. And this story hasn't ended, guys. Like this story is ongoing and it's like an onion. Every time you peel it, you get another layer, and then there's another layer, and then there's another layer, and it's like never ending. This family has fucking caused so much chaos and gotten away with so much. The fact that they're finally getting what's coming to them is insane. Like I'm talking about, this has been going on for over 100 years of them getting away with crimes.
I guess money does pay off, eh?
Yeah. Well,
up to a point.
You know, it's like that song, Money, Power, Respect. they no longer have the respect. They're losing the money. And they definitely lost their power. So, yeah, this is the story of the Murdaugh family.
That was a good analogy. Nice. I like that one.
Yeah.
Sorry. I did. I really thought that was good.
Yeah, thanks. I don't know. That's not even in the script. That's just the way I was thinking about it. Right,
I know.
Now.
I knew you just totally came off the top of your head. I know. The way you talked there, I know exactly. That was off the top of your head, which was really good.
Thanks. But, yeah. I have my moments.
Don't we all?
Yeah.
Once in a while, they call me JT Facts. You remember that? No.
Yeah, I have been listening to your Game of Thrones stuff. It was Nico Facts.
Yeah. Nico Facts. No, I know.
Oh. You know what? I love it that you guys reference me. And if, you know, even if it's like, you know, you guys are teasing me, I know it's all in good fun, but it always feels nice when I'm listening to one of your episodes and you guys bring up my name. Whether it be in like any indication whatsoever, I'm like, you know what? I really do have an impression on these guys.
See, that's what I was wondering. I was thinking about it the other day too, because I said Meister stats, that like the Meister from back in the game. So yeah, I'm thinking, how would you say it if it was a woman though? How would you say that if it was a woman? And I'm thinking, how would you say Meister as like an old woman in a sense? You know what I mean? I don't know.
I don't know. Let me look that up.
Woman, because I was thinking, I was like, yeah, maybe in a few years, like 20 years from now, we can call you that.
Yeah, maybe. Hold on.
So I wouldn't hide from the screen because it was afraid you're going to yell at me. But no.
Female version of Meister.
Yeah, because that I don't know. I just threw it came to my head too, and I was like, I'm going to start calling you that in 20 years from now when we're old.
It sounds like.
Maestress? I don't know. That's the only thing I was thinking
about. Female version of it? I don't know.
Maybe it's all the same. Who knows? Back then, you never know, right?
Yeah.
They didn't have Gillette shavers for the women, so you never know. All right.
Alrighty.
So let's get on with these dumb.
Let's get on with this. Guys, this is going to be a doozy, and it's going to be a bit of a long one, so bear with me. There's so much information, so much evidence to uncover here.
Just a quick thing before the beginning of the show, as Leslie didn't get to it, I wondering why I only had 4 pages, and I thought, oh, okay, because the font is smaller on the Word document. I'm going, maybe that's why, right? And then she sends me the readjusted one that I didn't know, and there's 13 fucking pages. So I'm like, oh, okay.
Minus the videos.
But I like these letters better. They're bigger. So the font size is bigger.
You know, at our old age, we can get all the help we can get. Like, we need all the help we can get. We can use it, yeah.
Yeah.
So without further ado, this is the story of the Murdaugh family. Murdaugh, as Alec likes to call himself, the Murdaugh family. It's not murder. It's Murdaugh. So
you keep up with those accents. I'm loving them.
So last episode, we did the story of a Canadian rich spoiled brat and how money and connections. No, because you're not rich and spoiled.
But not rich.
Last episode, we did the story of the Canadian rich spoiled brat and how money and connections were able to have him get away with murder. And then until he wasn't. And this episode, we're talking about an entire family who for over 100 years did this exact same thing, but on a whole new different level. But these two cases show that just maybe sometimes justice is served, or at least partially, and that no one should ever be above the law. Now, this family is from not just South Carolina. They're from South Carolina. They're South Carolina. They're from the south part of South Carolina. That's how southern they are.
Southern South Carolina.
Yeah. Where you still see plantations, predominantly anti-gay conservative white communities, and small towns laid out in vast fields, just like those movies portray them. Okay. And from 1920 to 2006, the Murdaugh family was led by lawyers. Liars, like they call them, liars.
Oh my god, if you had to speak in a southern accent the whole time, this would be crazy.
Oh my god, I really could, but it's just so fucking annoying.
I should have done that with the Google thing.
Yeah.
To play with me. Play me back. Yeah,
that would have really set you in the scene. That would really set you in the scene. If you don't do that. So from 1920 to 2006, the Murdaugh family was led by lawyers who were specifically solicitors. So solicitors, meaning they oversaw all criminal cases, like prosecutors. So insurance crimes, murder crimes, liabilities, you name it, like any type of law, they represented as solicitors. Okay. And they shook hands with judges. Some of them even became judges. Sheriffs, police, you name it. They friended them. They control. Totally. This is exactly how this family did, except like hillbilly. Yeah.
Yeah, hillbilly style.
Yeah. They control them. They judge them. Literally own them. In 2006, they started their own firm, and this is when their wealth came into play alongside their control, making it impossible to go up against them. There wasn't a case that they wouldn't win, basically.
Okay.
At the head of these snakes were Alex, and how he pronounces, it's not Alex, even though it's spelt Alex. It's pronounced Alec. Yeah.
Don't ask why, right?
Yeah. Murdaugh, and his wife Maggie, and the two kids, Richard Alex Murdaugh Jr., but I like to call him Buster, and Paul Murdaugh. He's my papa. That's his nickname, Papa.
Oh my god, sorry. I don't know. Seriously. I'm trying. I'll see if I can get through this one, guys, and see how much other guys you can make me laugh with this fucking accent. Go on.
So I'm gonna start you guys off with Papa. So Paul Murdaugh, his youngest son, and his wife's Maggie Murdaugh's deaths. Okay. And this is when it all starts crumbling down. Okay. It's a summer's night around 10 p.m. and Alex comes home to find his wife Maggie, who is 52, and his son Papa, Paul, 22. Murdered by the kennels on one of his many properties in the state called in his estate. I wrote down state, but it's estate called Moselle. So these guys owned like this family. They even owned their own island and they owned like a shitload of properties in South Carolina, but their main property, like their main home, it had like, there was like a huge ass driveway. And then at the end of the driveway is this massive house. And then behind the massive house, just a few acres down, are a bunch of kennels where they keep their hunting dogs. Okay. And that's where his Alex's son and his wife were found murdered. Okay. They were shot to death. Okay. Now, during the 911 call, you can hear distraught Alex telling the dispatcher, that he got home and found them. Okay. He says that he touched the bodies to see if they were breathing. Mm-hmm. So, but here's what's fact. Okay. Paul was shot with a shotgun to the head and chest. Okay.
Okay.
And Maggie was shot multiple times with a semi-automatic rifle. So there were two different weapons that killed these two individuals at the same time. Like, not at the same time, but like around the same bracket of time.
Both damaging fucking weapons. They're not like your little average. Oh, I'm gonna hold a handgun to your head.
Exactly, right? Now, what's curious about this is the Murdaugh family owns a lot of guns. Like, they're very gun happy. Of course, they're from South Carolina, so they're everywhere. And they love to hunt. Right? Okay. Old hunting dogs over there. And they actually own these two specific weapons. Okay. Now that's not enough to say.
I don't understand. Like,
yeah, I don't
know.
What's
the point? Yeah. Because they got balls. They just want to show how big they are. That's all it is.
Yeah. Well, usually people who like to show how big their balls are have like little balls and little penises. The more you want to show off, the smaller your penis size is. It's more of a turnoff for women. Just FYI. No,
but it doesn't work for me because apparently I don't show off enough.
So this isn't shocking that they had these guns at home because they were very gun friendly. This doesn't point US. Alex. This is not exactly, even though they own those guns, it doesn't exactly say Alex was the murderer. Okay. But as the story unfolds, it was actually proven. Okay. That he was the murderer. So it's strange to have two separate weapons in a homicide. That is very strange.
Yeah, well, unless we got some Bonnie and Clyde, if it's there.
But like I said, it isn't impossible because the family owned a shit ton, right? So yeah. What's interesting, though, is that the family owned these two rifles. Now, Sled, S-L-E-D, is South
Carolina. Is that somebody's name? Oh, no. I thought somebody's name for a second.
No. Is South Carolina's police division. Okay. Mm-hmm. And they took over the investigation early on because they felt the county sheriff's office had way too many handshakes done between them and the family. So if you know what I mean, major conflict of interest there, you know, because like this family is known to shake hands with everybody. So they're like, yeah, no, Mr. Sheriff, we're taking over. Okay. Mm-hmm. So although right off the bat, Alec was a suspect, his alibi was that he was taking his sick father to the hospital. Now, the story was then changed, which is suspicious number one. Okay.
Okay.
I was at my mother's and she has dementia. And eventually both alibis were found to be utter bullshit because Paul literally from the grave dismantled both alibis. You see, 10 minutes, just 10 minutes before his death,
okay.
Paul Snapchatted a video with his dad in it.
And technology.
His dad, yeah, right? And his dad was talking to his mother. Okay? This proved without a doubt that Alex lied and he was in fact at the crime scene when his wife and son were murdered. Okay? So there was the question of motive, and the rest of this crazy story will lead you to possible motives. And here's
So the Snapchatted thing, you said Paul Snapchatted the video, right, with his dad.
Right. So he was Snapchatting a video, right? And in the background, his dad is heard talking to his mom. And the video is timestamped around the time of death. You know when you do an autopsy and someone... Yeah,
because it was Snapchatted like a video, they're basically saying he was, in a sense, he's on the scene, in a sense.
Right. So he was saying he wasn't even there. He got home and found his mother, his wife and son murdered. Right.
Yeah.
So he was saying he wasn't even there. And what happened was, sorry, my son just came in. What happened was,
It's okay.
LJT, I say hi.
Hey, what's up?
Yeah, he says, hey, what's up?
Oh my God.
So what happened was he ended, so he says, he's telling the cops first he went to the hospital with his dad because his dad is very ill, which was true. His dad was extremely ill, right? Mm-hmm. But then he says, no, I didn't make it to the hospital the second time he was interviewed. I actually ended up staying home with my mom, but she's got dementia. And then I left my mother's. And when I got home, Maggie and Papa were dead. They were dead, right?
Oh, my God, yeah.
But Alex, dumbass, doesn't understand technology. And his son literally had a Snapchat that was timestamped. Mm-hmm. Meaning that it was when I say timestamped, it means that
most of these devices are
right, but like its original and its original video showed the time that not that it was sent,
not
that
sent, it was, but it was recorded. Yeah,
recorded. Right.
Yeah.
So
same like when you do a video on your phone, right? Like a regular video. Yeah, you can find the details.
Right. So survey says, Alec, you lie. Yeah. You liar. You liars.
You know, they even, I sorry, just for on a little side note on that, but you know, with that technology, they even have the your GPS location in like longitude and all that crap of where.
Right, but you could do that on Facebook too and Instagram.
No, but I mean, like, is what I'm saying. Yeah, but it'll tell, it's like a timestamp with the time of the picture or the video.
Yeah, but your phone has a GPS automatically too. So when you video record anything, you can timestamp anything, right?
Yeah,
you can
it'll GPS, do it purposely.
Like you got like iPhones even
for this reason. My phone.
I can log into my laptop, log into the Apple app, and it'll tell me where my phone is, right?
And that's even if the location is off, because it'll turn itself on by you activating it from your device. Exactly. No, so it's actually good for a reason like this if they needed murder scenarios, right? It is.
Right.
You know? So, but did you want me to put the video up?
So this is what you're about to hear is the 911 call of Alec calling 911 after he found Maggie and Papa.
After he found them?
Yeah, after he found them. Quotations. Found them.
So I was just seeing if you were going to correct yourself when I said that, but it worked. You did. It wasn't really a fuck up, guys. I'm just messing with her, buying myself some time to get to the
video.
Video. Here we go. All right, guys.
Where's your emergency?
This is Alec Murdaugh at 4147 Moselle Road. I need the police to answer immediately. My wife and child just got badly.
Okay, you said 4147 Moselle Road in Allison?
Sir?
You said 4147 Moselle Road in Allison?
Yes, sir. 4147 Moselle Road.
Stay on the line with me, okay? Hurry. Yes, sir. Stay on the line with me, okay?
Connor County Communications.
Collison, I have an Alex Murdaugh on the line. Caller from 4147 Moselle Road. He's advising that his wife and child was shot.
Okay, and sir, give me the address again.
It's 4147 Moselle Road. I've been up to it now. It's bad.
Okay. Okay, and are they breathing?
No, ma'am.
Okay, and you said it's your wife and your son?
My wife and my son.
Are they in a vehicle?
No, ma'am. They're on the ground out at my kennel.
Okay, and did you see anyone? Okay, is he breathing at all?
No.
Is she? Okay, do you see anything? Do you see anyone in the area?
No, ma'am. No, ma'am.
What color is your house on the outside?
It's white. You can't see it from the road.
Okay, is it a house or a mobile home?
It's a house.
Okay, and what is your name?
My name is Alec Murdaugh.
Okay, did you hear anything or did you come home and find them?
No, man, I've been gone. I just came back.
Okay, and was anyone else supposed to be at your house?
No, ma'am. Please hurry.
We're getting somebody out there to you. Okay, what is her name?
Maggie and Paul.
Maggie is her name?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
And please hurry.
We're getting somebody out there to you. Me asking you these questions, don't slow them down, okay? And you sure they're not breathing? Is he moving at all, your son? I know you said that she was shot, but what about your son?
Nobody's. They're not. Neither one of them's moving.
What is your telephone number? And does anything look out of place?
Ma'am, not particularly, really, no, ma'am.
Okay.
Are they close, ma'am?
Yeah, they've been around with you ever since you've got on the phone with me. I have multiple people coming out there to you. Okay. I don't want you to touch them at all, okay? I don't know if you've already touched them, but I don't want you to touch them just in case they can get any kind of evidence, okay?
I already touched them trying to get to see if they were breathing.
Okay. Well, I just don't want you to move anything just in case they can get any kind of evidence, okay?
So, what do you think of this?
Well, you know what I found interesting is listening to it. He had one type of talk when he was... When he first called, when he first was talking to them, right? Mm-hmm. He was talking one way, and then I noticed that when she was at, he was able to calmly, what's the word I'm looking for?
All of a sudden, calmly. He went from hysterical to calm.
Yeah, right?
Right? And
that's what I thought, and was able to reevaluate his questions. I noticed that too.
Right?
And like, when you're freaking out and panicking, I think especially if you just walked into something as horrific as that's supposed to be, like he kind of, and then I think she had him second guessing himself too when she asked if there was anything out of place.
Yeah.
In a sense, I feel like
it's a weird 911 call.
Well, but I feel like that the good thing about the 911 call is that it kind of because the panic, the crying, and all that. I mean, it went from like blubbering idiot in the beginning to, you know, like barely even hesitating in the voice. It's just now he's breathing heavy and he's calm. Like he was making sure too that they heard him.
Right.
You know, and he's throwing in the hair, you know, I touched the body. Okay, yeah, we you know, but they'll figure that out when you get there. That's not the first thing you tell them, right?
Right. Now, here's something else. By the time, so the sheriff got there, but because this 911, they called 911, it was also dispatched to SLED, right? Which is the southern state of Carolina. It's above the sheriff, right?
Yeah.
And when SLED got there, Alec had his brothers there.
Okay.
Alec had...
Oh, wow.
Like, a whole bunch of shitload of fucking family members over all of a sudden. And they were all contaminating the crime scene. He asked his maid, before the cops even got there, to clean the house.
Wow, eh?
Yeah. So everything is so sus. Everything about this is so sus, right? But so the cops, you know, like there's such a high percentage of domestic violent crimes that, of course, the husband or the wife are always the prime suspects, right?
Oh, for sure. Yeah.
But before they got Papa's phone, right? Yeah. Paul's phone that proved that Alec was there. They thought Alec was telling the truth, that he was really at his mom's because his mom corroborated that he was there. right?
Okay, yeah, yeah.
But his mom has dementia, right? And that's not the problem. The problem was he didn't lie about going to his mom. The problem was he came back from his mom's way before the murders happened.
Okay, so the time, yeah, the timing.
And the Snapchat video confirmed that.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah, with the timestamp.
So now we're going to get to another story that is connected to the Murdaugh family. And now it's connected to Alex's old, like, by the end of this all, I'm going to tell you a lot of different stories that happened around this family surrounding these suspicious deaths, right? And how they all tie in at the end to one another, okay? So, like, I'm giving you pieces of each puzzle by telling you each complete story first, and then at the end, I'll explain how it all intertwines together like a perfect web, all right?
Yeah.
So, now, Papa is the youngest son of Alec and Maggie, right?
Okay.
And Papa's the one who got shot, Paul. Okay, he was 22. But Alec has an older son, and his nickname is Buster, right?
Yeah.
So Buster had some run-ins too. So he got kicked out of law school, right? And he was known for terrorizing a very openly gay kid named Stephen Smith. Okay. Now, let's talk about Stephen Smith's death.
Okay.
Okay. Early morning of July 8th, 2015.
Yeah.
So 5 years before Paul and Maggie died. Okay.
Okay.
At approximately 4 a.m., Stephen Smith, a 19-year-old nursing student, was found on the middle of a two-lane road called Sandy Run Road. And he was dead from an apparent hit and run. Okay. Now, this is why this isn't just a conspiracy. Okay. I'm going to tell you it's not a hit and run. Okay. It was a literally a 2-minute drive from the Moselle property owned by the Murdaughs. Okay, not suspicious enough. You know, deaths happen. You know, anyone can die outside of my door, right? Stephen's crime photos clearly stated this wasn't a hit and run. He had a 7-inch laceration on his head. Okay. No signs of a vehicle, meaning there were no skid marks. Okay. No broken glass. His clothes were still on. No other trauma to the body except to his face and shoulder. So his head and shoulder. Okay. That's it. His shoes were still on, even though they were loosely tied.
Okay.
So if he got hit by a car, those shoes would have gone flying. Right.
Yeah.
And they didn't fly off when he was hit. Like, okay, that makes no sense. And a lot of questions. And every time the patrol officers went back to the scene of the crime, no indications pointed to a vehicle being involved. Now, yeah. I don't know if anybody here listening has ever hit an animal. Man, like, you get skid marks. Like, the minute you slam on your brakes, your tires are skidding. There are skid marks on the road. Okay?
Yeah.
There's nothing. Imagine a human being, right? Like, there was nothing. Nothing. Mm-hmm. See, the link here between Stephen and the Murdaugh family is that Stephen was an openly gay man and he was having a sexual relationship on the down low with Buster. This is the rumor. Okay?
Okay. And it's now, a rumor?
So, Buster has denied involvement. Obviously, he's not going to admit, yeah, I killed, you know, Stephen, right? Yeah. Or that he was even having sex, especially in a southern town where being gay is a no-no, right? Like, it's very conservative over there.
Oh, yeah.
And in a town where being gay was a no-no, Buster had motive, and the police were getting bombarded. I mean bombarded from the town, pointing the finger at Buster. Like, every single human in that town was pointing the finger at Buster. So okay. The coroner was the only person who called this a hit and run. Everyone else, including the patrol police, found no evidence of it being a hit and run. And when the judge asked this coroner, like, why did you call it a hit and run? She basically said, well, he was found on the road dead. What else could it be?
What else could it be?
Yeah. Like, she's an idiot. The mother went as far as to have an open casket to show that her son was beaten to death. According to Stephen's boyfriend, Stephen was being harassed by a group of boys in the area for a few months. He was harassed for being gay by being followed, and they would fuck with his car. On the night of his death, his car was actually found just up the road with all his stuff in there. Okay, so wow. His car had no gas, but the gas gouge on the side of the car, it was open. So they tried to make it look like he ran out of gas while was walking down the street, right? Okay. To go get gas by himself at 4 a.m. in the morning, which is a bunch of bullshit because you left the fucking gouge in. Like, if you run out of gas, you don't need to fucking open your gouge. What are you going to do? Beat through? Do I see any in there?
I don't. What are you talking about? You're talking about the thing that closes it?
Yeah. I
don't have one. I see in my car. I don't have one. So,
how do you put gas in your car?
It's sealed. So as soon as you put the thing in, it just
cool.
That hole that's there.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. That hole that's there. There's nothing on. I thought every time even to this day, like now that I got the rental, I open the door and I forget that thing's there. So I have to take it off, right? But then when I get my car back, I'm going to go like this, and I'm going to go look for it, because I was doing that for the first year of having that car. Yeah, I was going, you know, because I'm used to reaching for the cap, right?
Right.
You know, there was nothing there. It's so weird. It's such a technology is just, that threw me off just because you called it. You called it a gouge. I just want to make sure you were talking about the right thing, a gas cap.
The thing,
right?
The thing. So
yeah, I thought you were maybe saying that I was debating whether you were talking about the door part, and I was like, oh,
no, it was the door and the twisty thing that you put thing is all open.
Okay.
And the case went and there was no gas in the car. Now you're going to tell me how do you conclude in your head that someone left the car to go get gas, but his wallet and keys were left in the car? He only had his phone on him.
Well, I mean, technically, all you needed your phone, really, anyway. So that's another one that's kind of like, okay, we can have that toss in the air a little bit. We don't know where that's going to land. It's a hit or miss. Right?
So the case goes cold for a year. But Stephen's family kept getting notified that the Murdaugh brothers had something to do with it. So with the rumor spreading, Alex's brother Randy decided to pay the family a visit and offer his services pro bono. Okay.
Ooh, Randy. Now
that's suspicious, right? Like, why do you need to offer something like pro bono services? But because I like to get some things from the horse's mouth, this is a letter that Sandra Smith, Stephen Smith's mom, sent to the FBI begging them to investigate her son's case. Okay. Dear sir, ma'am, my family is in desperate need for your help. My 19-year-old son, Stephen Nicholas Smith, was murdered on July 8th, 2015 in Hampton County, South Carolina. It has been apparent from the first week of this investigation that authorities are covering up critical evidence and we no longer know who to trust. Stephen's father, my ex-husband, who is now deceased, and I were first told that our son was shot to death after running out of gas in the early hours of the morning and exiting his vehicle. Later that day, we were told it was a hit and run. Finally, investigators determined he was beaten to death. He was attacked so violently that the entire side of his face was rebuilt with putty for his funeral. Hampton investigators asked us at that time to continue to publicly say it was a hit and run. They claimed they didn't want the killer to know they were looking for him. There have been no named suspects. The first call my family received after the murder was from authorities notifying us of Stephen's death. The second came very quickly, the same morning, from Solicitor Randolph Murdaugh. So Randy Murdaugh is Alec Murdaugh's brother. Mm-hmm. Okay. In fact, he called my ex-husband's cell phone as we waited in the police station for positive identification. He said he heard of the case and was interested in working pro bono as a liaison between the family and investigators. Stephen's father accepted the offer, although we were unsure why Mr. Murdaugh wanted to help us. We also weren't sure how he found out so quickly, even before it was confirmed to be our son. Surprisingly, after just a few interactions, Mr. Murdaugh stopped returning our calls. Within days of our son's death, Stephen's twin sister, Stephanie, was approached multiple times by peers, telling her that Solicitor Murdaugh's nephews were responsible. As a family, it was suspicious to us, since he had taken such an immediate interest in the case and then became unreachable so quickly. These suspicions reached new heights weeks later when Stephen's older brother, Chris, was approached at work by a young man he did not know. This person told Chris he was present when Stephen was murdered and witnessed everything firsthand. He said that Solicitor Murdaugh's nephew, Buster Murdaugh, who graduated with Stephen, beat Stephen to death with a baseball bat. He claimed it was because Stephen was gay. Stephen was, in fact, gay. The witness said that they were smashing mailboxes when they came upon Stephen, and Buster seized the opportunity. The young man told Chris that Buster threatened to kill him if he ever spoke up. This information was given to investigators, but nothing came of it. In reviewing a copy of the 911 dispatch log, which I have enclosed, tab A, page 2. So she has receipts, okay? Mm-hmm. I found that the first responding officer, Michael Bridges, arrived on the scene within a minute of 911's dispatch, even though in the Hampton County Sheriff's Office incident report, tab B, he claimed to have driven around for a while trying to find my son's body. The second officer, Jason Eubanks, arrived within 2 minutes. This is suspicious to me because the area where my son was placed is extremely rural. Cops do not patrol that area frequently, and it's not likely an officer, much less two, would coincidentally be patrolling there prior to 5 a.m. They had to be in that area at the time for a reason. I suspect they were there because they already knew Stephen was there. And I suspect the Murdaughs were the ones who told them. The Murdaughs are probably the most prominent family in Hampton County. Stephen had more than one occasion mentioned to friends and his twin sister that he was involved romantically with someone from a prominent family in the county who was hiding his sexuality. He said it would shock people to know this person was gay. We suspect this could be this young man Stephen was referring to, though he never named him. At the beginning of the investigation, officers told us they would not have access to Stephen's text messages for approximately a year. They claimed they would have to send the phone to Apple to override the security features. We found out months later the phone had never been sent to Apple. Often, investigators claimed it was uncertain which department had the phone. They have since produced the phone, which they still have not sent to Apple, but still claim they cannot access it. We feared then and still fear now that they have and will continue to delete critical information from the phone. it has already been over a year and we have no knowledge of who Stephen interacted with by phone, call, or text prior to his murder. Since the murder, Buster has gotten rid of his old vehicle, which is critical because according to the witness who approached Chris, they were traveling in Buster's old vehicle that night. It's also critical because Stephen was found 3 miles from his vehicle on the morning of his murder. There was no blood splatter on the crime scene despite his brutal beating, which makes it clear he was transported to that site. We believe there is DNA in Buster's old vehicle. I think it's important to note that Stephen's wallet was found in his own vehicle and his gas cap was off it, was open, further suggesting he did not leave willingly. Stephen was very skittish and would never walk down the road in the dark. And it's not like he would have opened his car door to accept assistance from someone he did not know, especially alone on a dark country road. He was even known to walk through the woods during the day to stay out of sight. His autopsy shows his toxicology reports were negative for drugs and alcohol. So I have no reason to believe he would have done something so completely out of character. Since Stephen was placed on the highway, it became a highway patrol investigation. We thought this was beneficial to Stephen, since local authorities obviously have their own agenda. However, this did not help our case at all. This case was mysteriously bounced from investigator to investigator without reasons or notification. It would repeatedly get to a certain point when the assigned investigators would bow out, perhaps not wanting to take on Solicitor Murdaugh. So like they would literally, the minute they would get the case, they would say, oh, I'm not taking it. It's a Murdaugh case.
Fuck that. Yeah. They're like, we're not going to win. Yeah.
I was approached in September 2015 by a gentleman claiming to know about a criminal case decades ago that was swept under a rug to protect a different member of the Murdaugh family. This came as no surprise to me. I see history repeating itself with my son. No one here is trying to solve our case. Therefore, I contacted Governor Nikki Haley that same month with a plea for help. I wrote her a letter telling her basically word for word the story I have just explained to you. She responded promptly and assigned the case to 2 new investigators. While it appeared to be an answer to our prayers, very little progress has been made, and they say they have exhausted their leads. I cannot fathom how that is possible. Our concerns regarding Solicitor Murdaugh and his family have not been investigated despite witness accounts, which include an alleged conversation between a schoolmate of Buster's little brother, Paul, and school officials. I was told he claimed to have knowledge of the murder and implicated Buster as the murderer. Those school officials were said to have discussed the statement with the student's family, not police. We have heard no further follow-up to this situation. Interestingly, according to my source, Paul was transferred from that school to a private school after the alleged statement. We believe Solicitor Murdaugh's influence extends to the pathologist, Dr. Aaron Presnell of MUSC, who performed Stephen's autopsy. That's the spots I told you about earlier.
Yeah.
Though Deputy Coroner Kelly Green and SLED agent Brittany Burke, who were both present for the autopsy, have gone on the record to state that neither made any mention of a car striking Stephen, Dr. Presnell ruled his death as a hit and run. She was combative with the Highway Department investigator, Todd Proctor, regarding her findings, and when he pointed out that the only trauma was to Stephen's head, he asked how she came to that conclusion, and she said it was because he was found in the road. That alone was her reason. She insisted hit and run despite the fact that neither his injuries nor the crime scene support that finding. The coroner disagrees with her determination, and it is documented multiple times in the case file that there were no skid marks or vehicle debris consistent with a hit and run at the crime scene. Dr. Presnell herself confirmed to investigator Proctor that she found no glass or other fragments on the body to suggest it a hit and run. It's simply not possible that a vehicle struck solely his head. Coroner Ernie Washington, informed investigator Proctor that Dr. Presnell told him she would change her report to read however he wanted it.
Nice.
Right? Copies of investigator Proctor's summary notes, which document his discussions with Dr. Presnell and Coroner Washington, are enclosed. So she's got receipts of this information too. Okay. We desperately need your help. This investigation is being deliberately derailed. We need someone to hold the investigators accountable and access Stephen's phone. Solicitor Murdaugh is widely known, and it appears that this is playing to his advantage. We need someone who doesn't care about his family named to take this case seriously. In July 2016, I wrote the Attorney General, Loretta Lynch, in the hopes that she could and would help us, but there has been no response. I have enclosed the key documents I mentioned above, but I can provide copies of all the case documents I have at your request. We also have new information which we discovered in the past few weeks, and we feel it is critical to this case. However, no longer trust the investigators here. I am holding it as I await your response. I can be reached at, and I'm not going to say the phone number. I thank you immensely.
So weird numbers there.
Well, of course, it's weird to you because you're not from South Carolina, okay?
No, I'm just saying it's weird the number being like openly displayed like that.
I know this isn't redacted, and I just won't share any of her personal information, but all her personal information.
No, yeah.
It just should have been redacted when it was published, and it wasn't. I thank you immensely for your time and help. Sincerely, Sandra Smith.
So they this should have never been kept out there. This is out there for public knowledge to see, like public.
Yeah.
Well, this is a good way to prove that how it started off, in a sense. I mean, it is a good letter to have to publicly document stuff. Like, I mean, she did a good job. I feel this.
And
is,
she has receipts.
Like a lawyer writing this.
Right.
This seems she like has a lawyer or something, right? Writing this shit.
She has receipts, man. She's got receipts of everything.
Molly.
Yeah. As of now, the family has raised enough money to get Stephen's body exhumed and have an independent autopsy done. The police sled have officially reopened the case and are now considering it a homicide. And they said they found evidence linking the Murdaughs to Stephen's case, but cannot divulge the information. So no one knows what they have as of yet because it's all still ongoing. Now, I added on some information that's not on there, JT.
Those 10 pages.
Right. Yeah. This past weekend, a couple of more things have occurred. The body was finally exhumed. Sled said that there was a rape kit conducted when they found the body. So the first time they found the body, they actually conducted a rape kit, but they never tested it. Yeah.
So they could still see this in on the body, like even after.
Well, that's evidence. No. They found that evidence of the rape kit when they took the body the first time, right after.
Oh, so it was on before. Yeah. So it was never like this is.
But it was never tested. Before, it was prior never to tested.
The burial.
Why? Yeah. If it was a hit and run, why would you do a rape kit?
I'm trying to think of something. I'm trying.
Yeah, right.
To.
You
I'm,
can't. I'm, right. I mean, like it's all bullshit, right?
I can't say nothing that's not going to hurt the person who died's feelings. That's what I mean. I can't.
Right.
Yeah, so I'm not saying anything, but I can't think of.
And
anything.
As of yesterday, it was confirmed that they completed the autopsy and that more evidence has been accumulated as a result. Now they're keeping it as the. Yeah.
You think the Murdaugh family? It would wanted to know if whether one of them raped him.
No, the Murdaugh family didn't tell them to do a rape kit. The police officer,
coroner did, obviously, probably.
Right. And then she said, oh, it was a hit and run. And I'm going to tell you whatever the fuck you want to hear. Right. It was a hit and run. There you go. Yeah. And as of yesterday, it was confirmed that they completed the autopsy. And that more evidence has been accumulated as a result. Now, they're keeping it as quiet as possible because this is an ongoing investigation, so they can't really divulge everything, right? And his phone is finally unlocked, and it's in Sled's possession and currently being investigated as well. Now, the family has been able through GoFundMe not to just get enough funding to get his body exhumed, which they were successful doing, but to do their own private autopsy and add a $35,000 reward with anyone with information that will lead to a conviction.
You know what's funny, though? But really, okay, if everybody that knows is loaded, really, and is covering it up is loaded, then $35,000 is not much. I mean, it's good for the guy in school that maybe knows them and, you know,
right,
knows some information, right, that can give it out. But that's kind of crazy that they, because they obviously didn't come from money, his family there.
No.
And if they're getting, have to do a
but
GoFundMe.
They got a GoFundMe, yeah, and they got enough to exhume the body, get it autopsied by a private autopsy.
That's kind of crazy. It's expensive, and it's surprising you have to pay for all that, right?
Yeah.
Fuck, man. They should be charging the fucking family for that, those fees afterwards. Not for anything, but whoever killed this, the son.
Oh yeah, right? Yeah. But what's sad is that. Yeah, I don't know, man.
What's sad is that what?
There is no statute of limitations when it comes to murder, right?
Or rape too, right? In that sense.
No, there is on rape.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah.
I didn't think there was, but except yeah, okay.
Every state differs. I don't know what duration. It is in Canada, but every in the U.S., every state differs what that year is. So some are 5 years,
yeah.
Some are 10 years, some are 20 years, right?
Yeah, because they all fucking like to be independent over there, whatever.
Yeah. Now
I honestly thought there was no like there was no limitations because you know the people speak up years later, right?
So, yeah.
I mean, okay. You want to now, see the video now?
Wait, yeah, this is now case number 3. Okay.
Sure, yeah, case number 3. It's fucking crazy.
Yeah, so I've given you 2 cases. Now this is case number 3, okay? Maggie and Alec Murdaugh versus Gloria Setterfield. Now, Gloria Setterfield was the Murdaugh family nanny. Okay, she basically
Got a fucking nanny. These right. Rich people, sorry.
So she was really kind to Paul. Maggie, I'm not saying anybody deserves to die. Okay, were the people who died good people? Not so much. But did they deserve to die? No. But Gloria, so Maggie and Paul, the youngest child, the one who got shot with his mom, right? They weren't very close. Maggie was like her golden boy was her oldest son, Buster, and her young, like the other one wasn't, you know, Paul and her just butt heads all the time. But Gloria raised Paul and she loved Paul and he loved her. Okay. And so anybody you ask, no matter how many awful things they have to say about Paul, they will tell you they know for a fact that guy, it could have been impossible for him to have anything to do with her death because he loved her that much. Okay. But first play the 911 call, the Maggie Murdaugh Gloria Setterfield 911 call.
911, what is your emergency? 4147 Meadowdale Road. Hey, can you give me the address one more time? Make sure I got it right. Yes, 4147.
That's Maggie.
Meadowdale Road. Okay, what's going on out there? I'm sorry? What's going on out there? My housekeeper has fallen and her head is bleeding. I cannot get her up. Okay, you said she's fallen. She's bleeding from her head? Yes. Okay. How old is she? I'm not sure, like 58 maybe. Do you know if she fell from standing or not? No. Where'd she fall from? She fell going up the brick steps. Okay, so she had bed or inside? Outside. Okay. How many steps is there? 8. Okay, is she on the ground or is she up near the top?
She's on the ground. She's on the ground. She's on the ground.
Is she conscious?
No, not really.
Is she awake at all?
Yes.
Okay. Is she just not, like, responding appropriately, but she is awake?
Man, she's not, no, she's not responding.
Okay, I've already got them on the way. Me asking questions does not slow them down, man. Knowing if she's conscious is one of the things that the medic needs to know. If she's responding
really.
At all to you?
No.
Okay, so she's not responsive at all?
Well, I mean, she's mumbling.
Okay, so she is somewhat conscious. Is she breathing okay?
Yes.
Is she bleeding from anywhere?
Yes, her head.
Okay, are you guys able to control the bleeding?
No.
Can you put a clean rag or anything on it?
Yeah, I got it.
Okay, is she bleeding from, like, her face, the back of the head?
I've got an ambulance coming. Sir, my name what?
Where exactly is she bleeding from on her head?
I'm not sure, the top of her head.
Okay.
What's it okay?
What happened?
She just fell back down. Can I get off this phone so I can go down there?
Can I have your name and phone number? Or are you able to bring the phone down by her?
What?
Are you on a cell phone where you can walk down there
I'm
and talk?
On a cell phone, no.
Okay, can you bring it with you so we can ask her some questions about what kind of pain she's having?
Hello?
Yeah, can you ask the patient what kind of pain she's having?
Ma'am, she can't talk.
Okay, do you know...
She's cracked her head and there's blood on the concrete and she's bleeding out of her left ear.
Okay, she's bleeding out of her ear?
And out of her head. She's cracked her skull.
Okay. All right, the other lady said that she had tried to stand up and fell down again?
No, I was holding her up. And
okay.
She told me to turn her loose and she was trying to use her arm, but then she fell back over.
Okay, do you guys know who she is?
Yes, yeah, she works for us.
Okay, do you know if she's ever had a stroke or anything before?
Ma'am, can you stop asking her questions?
I already have them on the way. Me asking questions does not slow them down in any way. These are relevant questions that I have to ask for the ambulance. One of my questions is, has she ever had a stroke?
I don't believe she's ever had a stroke, not that I know
okay.
that.
Okay. Okay, is she able to talk to you guys at all, or is she unconscious now?
She's not unconscious. She's just mumbling.
Okay.
I believe she's maybe hit her head and maybe has a concussion or something.
Okay.
Maybe.
Do you know what her name is?
Gloria Satterfield.
You said Sanderfield?
Ma'am?
You said Sanderfield?
Satterfield.
Satterfield. Okay, what's the house look like out there?
It's offset off the road.
Okay.
It's a big house, got a long driveway.
With a long driveway?
Yeah.
Is there a gate or anything down there that they're going to need to come through?
There's two big brick columns that have to come through.
Okay, but there's no, like, gate code or anything that they need?
No, ma'am. And tell them that they can look for a fellow on a 6x6 Ranger.
Okay.
Waiting on them in the road is green. You know what the... They probably know what the Ranger looks like.
Yeah. You said, like,
fellas got on a black sweater,
okay.
A hat, and pants.
Okay. All right. If something changes with her, if she loses consciousness or anything like that, I need one of you guys to call me back right away, okay?
Okay, well, how long is it going to take? Cause this takes us
that I don't know. I've had them on the way since Maggie first called me. They were toned right away.
Okay.
All right, but I think they're coming. Hang on 1 minute. Let me check. They're coming from somewhere on Belt Highway in Ruffin, okay? That's where their station is.
Thank you.
All right, but like I said, if something changes, call me back.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
We just listened to the audio of Maggie and Paul's 911 call when Gloria fell. Okay. So this is
fucked up,
right? It even gets more fucked up. Okay.
He fucked up big time on that call. I must have pointed out 10 different things.
Well, the attitude coming out of Maggie, you know, like, come on, man. I would be a little more worried if someone that helped raise my son was hurt and bleeding from the head and barely conscious.
Yeah. But I mean, like, you don't even, they don't know if she's conscious or not conscious.
Yeah.
She's second guessing what they're saying.
Is she talking?
Yeah.
She's unconscious, but she's talking. How, what? Like, what?
Yeah.
Yeah, made no sense. Anyhow.
Why did it switch over?
Oh, because she was getting so frustrated talking to the dispatcher that she had to get her son to get on the phone, right? Wow. So in December of 2018, Alex settled a wrongful death suit between him and Gloria's family, okay? They said Gloria, who was the Murdaugh family housekeeper, tripped over the dogs and fell and hit her head. She was rushed to the hospital and died 20 days after being in the ICU. After the death, about a month later, Alec went to her family and said he could get them some insurance money if they believed him. Sorry, and they believed him, right? So yeah. He was like, I'm not going to let, you know, Gloria's family be without any money, and I'm going to help you with from the goodness of my heart. I'm going to make sure you're going to get some insurance money so y'all could survive without Gloria, you know?
Okay.
You see, they didn't know what, this is what the family didn't know, right? Was that a month before her death, Alec had taken out an insurance policy on liable property, meaning if there ever were any accident on his property with staff, they can get insurance money. Now, we all know that all cases don't mean that if someone gets hurt on your property, you're automatically responsible, right?
Yeah.
But he made it sure that he was responsible, and he made sure that the judge knew, I'm responsible. My home is responsible. They need that money, okay?
But he knew that before the fact.
Right. So after 3 years of Alex saying he was going to take care of it to the family, they still hadn't heard anything. So no money, nothing. And then Maggie and Paul die. Okay. So years later, 2021, Maggie and Paul died. Okay. And in the article, okay, it said that $500,000 went to the family, which was news to the family because they didn't get anything. Hey, John, did you get anything? No, you knew. Well, why's the article saying we got $500,000? I don't know. We should call Alec. Let's call Alec. So.
Oh, my God. Your ad lib is too much.
So they hired lawyers to investigate where the money went. And the lawyers found out that Alec actually claimed $4.3 million of insurance money of liable death off Gloria Setterfield.
Wow.
Yeah.
So he took $4 million.
He took almost four and a half million dollars
just because she fell at his house.
And it's not even his money. That money was supposed to go to his family.
His estate or whatever, yeah.
Right? Because the insurance policy, when you do an insurance policy, it's your next of kin. It's not for your lawyer to get it or your boss.
Okay.
But he voluntarily said, I will help you get some money.
Yeah, yeah.
They eventually settled. In the documentary, they said that Gloria had found Alec's drugs under the bed. And that was another possible motive to oust the poor lady. As of today, as of today, the family is waiting for her body to be exhumed to further investigate her death too. Since no coroner ever examined the body after her death. The reason no autopsy was done was because she dies 21 days later. And in the hospital, and it was ruled a natural death because of it. Yeah. But now the family wants to confirm that her injuries were really sustained by an accident or if they were really foul play. Now, in the documentary, Paul's ex-girlfriend says there was no way Paul or Papa would have any involvement with her death because she was really good to him, especially when his own mother wasn't so good to him. And she also said that he was absolutely devastated when she died. But she definitely believes his dad, Alec, would have something to do with it, or his mom, Maggie, because they were definitely hiding something. She seemed annoyed that it happened. So Maggie's attitude when Gloria died was like annoyance. Like she was annoyed that it happened. And Alec lied to authorities and said he saw the whole thing when he wasn't even there.
The guy who picked up the phone.
No, Alec.
Oh, yeah.
So Alec told the cops.
Her husband, yeah.
Yeah, I was there. So Alec had a drug problem, okay? He had an opioid problem. He was hooked on oxys. And Gloria had...
Everybody?
No. I'm not, thankfully, you know. My heart breaks for anyone who is. It's not easy. Alec had a very bad opioid addiction. Okay. And he didn't just swindle money from Gloria's family. He swindled money from all his clients from the law firm and got kicked out of his own family law firm 3 weeks before Maggie and Paul were murdered.
Well, you didn't even say they were murdered. You just said they had died.
Well, when you're shot to death, that's a murder.
Yeah. This was prior. Yeah, no, I know. But I'm just saying, they threw me off because just a second ago you had said, yeah, you're dead already. Yeah. So yeah. I forgot all about those are the first ones you talked about. You're going backwards on me.
I told you I was going to tell you a lot of different stories, a lot of different pieces to puzzles, and they're all going to tie in together, right?
I mean, see, and even being high, I can still catch that part.
So now,
I like the wink. Sorry, I hope Julie sees it. She read this, this or watches it. Yeah.
So now we're going to Papa Paul Murdaugh, the other Murdaugh. Yeehaw.
I wish I had a soundbite that just said yeehaw.
And this is Paul Murdaugh versus Mallory Beach's death. Okay. Now, in February 2019, okay. Paul and his friends went on a boat ride heading to an oyster roast up the river. They were pretty drunk, especially Paul. They left one of the many properties that the Murdaughs have called Murdaugh Island. Yeah, these people have a whole fucking island, guys. And took the boat up the river to the roast. They stayed there for about 5 hours, and according to the deposition papers, one of his friends wanted to pitch in for an Uber, and Paul refused. Said, I'm not leaving my boat. So they all went back into the boat and at 1 a.m., at 1 a.m., and Paul was driving the boat really carelessly. Okay. Mallory said that she was scared. Paul's girlfriend spoke up and asked them to pull over. And this douchebag hits and spits on her and tells her to sit her ass back down in front of all their friends. Okay.
Fuckery.
After entering Archer's Creek, he purposely started driving even faster because he was pissed everyone was telling him to slow down. So it's like the more people were telling him to slow down because he was going nuts with the boat, right? Yeah. The more he drove erratically, the more speed he got. And so this idiot drives the boat right into Archer's Creek Bridge. Mallory and her boyfriend, Anthony, went to flying into water, but only Anthony came back up. Mallory's body was found a week later, 5 miles down the river. The police report said they were unsure who the driver was, but Anthony was adamant that it was Paul because the police report didn't claim to have Paul as the driver. Because the cops didn't report Paul as the driver, they forego the sobriety test. So they can't. No testament to the level of corruption that this family had with the cops. Do you get what I'm saying?
Well, they know the law, man. I mean, they got it pinpointed down, man. I mean,
yeah. So no sobriety test, no arrest, right? Currently, there's an obstruction of justice case against the Murdaugh family for this incident because Paul called his daddy and granddaddy to come help him fix this. And they get to the hospital and they start acting like liars and try to talk to each kid individually to put the blame on Paul's cousin Connor instead. Yeah. It took 3 months to get Paul eventually charged with this. Apparently, there's evidence missing, and in May 2019, Paul was ordered to stay within 3 counties at home, but no jail time, even though he was charged with 3 felonies, including manslaughter. Now, since Paul is dead, the family had no choice but to file a civil suit against the Murdaugh family instead for their daughter's death.
Civil suit.
Yeah. The hearing for this suit was supposed to happen on June 10th, 3 days after Paul's murder.
Oh.
According to the Beach family, this case required to have a ton of financial information submitted to court. That wasn't going to fly with Alec, right? Because then it would prove he's doing some funny business with money, right?
Yeah.
Coincidentally, just 3 days later, both Maggie and Paul were murdered. Now, put on the YouTube email that's called Mallory Beach.
Mallory Beach.
And this video was taken by police footage, like the police cam, the cops cam, right after the accident.
Right after the accident?
The boating accident.
Was it him that was in the boat or no?
No, press play. Those are Mallory's parents.
Oh, those, okay, those are her parents.
Yeah.
It would be like to go through something like this.
911, where's your emergency? Police, fire, ambulance. Hello?
February 24th, 2019, the night that put the Murdaughs back in the spotlight and changed the Beach family's life forever.
Please send someone.
We're coming, okay?
Investigators say Paul Murdaugh was driving a boat under the influence with 5 other teenagers, including Beach, when he crashed into a bridge near Paris Island.
5 of us are on the bank, but we're missing one person.
It's going way too fast. I don't even know. I finally got to the point I grabbed my girlfriend and put her in my lap in the bottom of the boat and was holding on with my eyes closed. The next thing I know, I'm in water.
Beach was gone.
Bro, you smiling like you're funny.
Sit down.
My girlfriend, go, bro.
Press pause.
This boat grossly intoxicated.
That's Anthony yelling at Paul because his girlfriend's gone and Paul's laughing.
I read that part off the screen. I got that part.
Yeah.
But that's fucked, eh?
Isn't that fucked up? Yeah. Go on. Press play again.
He's laughing. So that just shows you how fucking hammered you gotta be to be.
Not just hammered, sorry, man. No.
Just fucking.
No value.
White privilege?
Yeah. No value for any other human life whatsoever.
Wow.
Hated. Yet he wasn't issued a field sobriety test, nor did he ever spend a night in jail.
Y'all know Alec Murdaugh.
Oh yeah, I know his name.
That's his son.
That's so driving the boat.
Good luck.
Authorities, search teams, friends, and family searched for an entire week. Until
911, where's your emergency?
We think we found her.
Beach's body was found on March 3rd, 2019, in a marsh near the Broad River boat landing. Later that month, her family filed a wrongful death lawsuit against Alec and Buster Murdaugh, plus Parker's convenience store, who sold Paul the alcohol the night of the crash. April 18th, 2019 would have been Beach's 20th birthday.
It is hard. Yes, it's hard. There's moments that we have that things remind us of Mallory, and we break down at times.
It was also the day that Paul was indicted for boating under the influence, causing death, and two counts of boating under the influence, causing great bodily injury. Paul pleaded not guilty to all charges. The court-ordered mediation in the wrongful death lawsuit failed on June 4th, 2021, meaning the case would then head to trial. 3 days later, Paul and his mother, Maggie, are found shot to death at their family's hunting lodge.
At this hunting lodge, what the fuck? That, oh my God. He's like, I can't cover this one up any longer. Let's just go shoot him.
Yeah, you see how Anthony said, God. You know who that is? That's Alec Murdaugh's son. Good luck. Like, good luck trying to fucking put him in
jail. Oh my God.
Yeah.
They have a cleanup. They must have a cleanup crew for their family. Oh yeah. This is what it sounds like. Yeah, oh my God.
Yeah. On September 4th, 2021.
But it's so true. Sorry about the convenience store and then the liquor store or whatever it is that had sold them the booze. They could be charged too, at the same for the same thing, like because they're causing death. Like it's causing a death, right? To not do your shit properly.
Yep.
It's so true, but. So I don't know how big that company is in the South. So, I mean, they might want to cover stuff up too, right?
Yeah. So if you would think the story would get any fucking weirder, okay?
Just keep on going.
Let's just keep on fucking going. On September 4th, 2021.
That's somebody's birthday? No.
Yeah, it's fine.
Yeah, I was going to say.
Alec calls 911 and he says he's been shot. Apparently, the shooting happened 7 miles from the Moselle home where his wife and kid murdered. He says he was on the side of the road investigating a flat tire when someone shot him in the head. He was helicoptered to the hospital but considered in stable condition with a superficial gunshot wound to the head. Basically, this shot grazed his head. So SLED agents are back investigating. Not much else is known that as of Monday, September 6th, it comes out that Alec has been battling an opioid addiction. He was pushed out of his law firm for stealing money. And the knife matching the tire slashing belongs to who? Ding, 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 ding. Alex Murdaugh. He slashed his own fucking tire and got someone to fucking shoot him so that he could look like a victim, like he was next after Maggie and Paul's death.
Okay. So let's see this.
Alec Murdaugh's 911 call after the fake shot with the link.
Okay.
This is Alec Murdaugh at 4147 Moselle Road. I need the police to answer immediately. My wife and child got badly.
That was Alec Murdaugh on June 7th, 2021, reporting the murders of his wife Maggie and son Paul. Murdaugh's trial for the murders is underway in Colleton County, South Carolina. Nearly 3 months later, Murdaugh placed another 911 call from the side of a road where he claimed he was shot while changing a flat tire.
Hampton County 911, what is your emergency?
On Saucahatchee Road.
Okay, what's the address on Saucahatchee Road?
I'm by the church.
What church? What church are you talking about?
I don't know the name of it, with the red roof.
Okay, what end of Saucahatchee Road? Because I don't know what you're talking about.
At the Hampton County side.
Okay, what's going on?
I got a flat tire, and I stopped, and somebody stopped to help me. And when I turned my back, they tried to shoot me.
Oh, okay. Were you shot?
Yes, but okay. I mean, I'm okay.
You shot where? Where were you shot at?
Huh?
Did they actually shoot you, or they tried to shoot you?
They shot me, but...
Okay, wait, you need EMS?
Well, I mean, yes, I can't drive.
Okay. I'm having trouble seeing and I'm bleeding a lot. Where part of your body? Okay, I'm not sorry. Sure. Somewhere on my head.
Your head?
Somewhere on my head. Somebody just stopped for me, ma'am. For 911. Okay. Still?
Hey.
Okay, let me speak to him, see if he can tell me exactly where you are.
Talking at you, brother.
Oh, like
your body's church.
Right
at church?
Okay. Red Roof.
Yeah, hurry, please. Uh-huh. Okay, about 2 miles from the pedestrian road barrel.
Okay, and what's your name? I'm still here. I'm going to stay on the line with you. What's your name?
Alex Murdaugh.
Alex Murdaugh?
Yes, ma'am.
And you see, you were driving, you got a flat tire, and somebody stopped to help you, and they shot you?
Well, they pulled over, yes, ma'am, like they were going to help me.
Okay, stay on the line with me. We're going to get some.
I'm bleeding pretty bad.
Okay. Stay on.
St. John's Missionary Church.
St. John's Missionary Church?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
The SUV is
right where he's at. And can you give me a description of the person that shot you or shot at you?
Yes, ma'am. I mean, it was a white fella. I'd say
a white male,
a fair amount younger than me. Really, really short hair.
You have an ambulance coming, ma'am? Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Stay on the line. I got them on the way.
You think one of y'all can drive me to the hospital? Yes, sir. You want to get the trunk, though, because I got a baby and he's doing that.
One of y'all can get in this car and drive me?
Yes, sir.
They're going to drive me to the hospital. Ma'am?
Yeah, it should be cranked. And that's
911, where's your emergency?
Yes, ma'am, I lost you. This young lady is driving me to the hospital.
She's carrying you to the hospital?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, and who is this?
This is Alec Murdaugh. I was on the phone a minute ago.
Okay, all right. Okay. He said this young lady's taking him to the hospital. Okay.
Oh, yeah, look, we got a flat tire.
Got two, 10-12.
Ma'am, I need the ambulance.
You need the ambulance? Okay, are you still in the same location?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, which way are y'all heading? Are y'all driving down the road?
No, ma'am, I got a flat tire.
Okay, all right, Sit tight right there, okay?
Ma'am?
Okay. Yes, sir. We're still here. We're still here. Hold on. We're dispatching now, giving them information. Where are you at?
I
want
to get this all over your car. All right, now they're taking me to the hospital.
Okay, so which way are y'all traveling?
We're coming down Saucahatchee Road to the Hampton Hospital.
Y'all coming down Saucahatchee?
Ma'am?
Y'all coming down Saucahatchee Road to your to the hospital?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. They said that they're coming down. They're coming down Saucahatchee Road heading towards the hospital. But all right, we're going to keep EMS en route to you, okay?
Okay.
Are you coming off of Walterboro Highway?
We'll be at Walterboro Highway in 10 minutes or so.
They said in about 10 minutes or so they'll be in Walterboro Highway. What kind of vehicle are you in?
A white Nissan Rogue.
It's a white Nissan Rogue. In a white Nissan. 10-4, be advised on Walterboro Highway in a white Nissan Rogue. White Nissan Rogue.
Is the flashers on?
Y'all have a... No, Kimber, at this time, they're still 1017 to the hospital.
Ma'am?
Y'all still on the... Okay. Y'all still 17. Do you have your flashers on the vehicle? Is the flashers on? Okay. Is the flashers on?
Yes.
Hotel 12.
Your location for the individuals is the escort to the hospital.
Temporal, they're on Walterboro Highway.
All right, we see the ambulance, so we can pull over. Okay. Tell them we're in the white car.
They're in the white Nissan Rogue on Walterboro Highway. They are pulling over. They see the EMS.
Okay,
do you, y'all stopped?
I see them.
You're at Walterboro Highway? And where?
They're here. They're here.
Okay. Okay.
I'm going to hang up, ma'am.
Okay, then you...
Days later, Alec Murdaugh would admit the shooting was a suicide scheme he hatched with his friend and distant cousin, Curtis Eddie Smith, so his only living son, Buster Murdaugh, could get a $10 million life insurance payout. Stay with law.
Wow.
Bullshit!
That was sounded like a little bit, man. That fucking they're all sounding like bullshit, trust me. All the actual calls. Right? I understand more from a call than if it was on a piece of paper. Yeah, man, I can, because you can totally tell by the way they're confusing their voices. And I think they do that too intentionally if they think something's suspicious, because they see how they switch the lines, and then they have their talk of communicating to one thing. And so it kind of gets the person on the other line kind of distracted a little. So I don't know. I feel like that call is intentionally set so that it can get in evidence if it needs. You can tell there's a bunch of evidence to take out of that, right?
So this is, you want to know what really happened?
All right, let's see what really happened.
Okay.
So the real story
is what really happened.
Told
he
us,
hired but... Curtis Edward Smith, a family friend who's actually more of a distant cousin than a family friend of the Murdaughs.
All cousins down there.
Yeah, right? Right. Yeah. He was a cousin of Alec Murdaugh, who had questionable drug dealing, to shoot and try to kill him so that his son Buster could get $10 million in surviving settlement money. This is bullshit. I think he knew the cops were onto him and told him to graze him with the bullet so the cops could think that someone is trying to murder him. Just like they did my wife and son, right? Upon further investigation, they also found years of checks paid to Smith, each between $10,000 and $20,000. According to the investigators, in the documentary, that would have, like, all the years of payouts that he paid off Curtis for drug money, like he said, it would have accumulated 114 years of opioids. So there's no way Alex was just paying him for drugs. There was some other bullshit he was paying him for. So why was all this money being paid to Smith? That's still an unanswered question. Now, Sled found this all too suspicious and started investigating Maggie and Paul's murders more thoroughly. And this is when all the stories stopped matching. They went back to the Moselle home and found the clothes Alex was wearing, which tested positive for gunshot residue.
Oh, wow.
Also coinciding with the time stamped footage on Paul's phone, Alex was finally arrested. This month, he was found guilty and sentenced to life without parole for both murders. He's appealing this, but I don't think it'll go anywhere. He was too sloppy. The judge was pretty hard on him, and in the video, you'll see his reaction at the sentencing. So the sentencing of Alex Murdaugh, this is a short video.
Where is it? Hold on. Where are you all?
It says sentencing of Alex Murdaugh.
Pretty sure. There it is.
I respect this court, but I'm innocent.
I liked it. What the fuck? I actually accidentally liked it. Hold on. We might have to.
I would never.
And I get this back to the beginning. It's a short, right?
Yeah.
We can start it back at the beginning. That's okay. Let's see what happens. You did hear just what it said, right?
Yeah.
This one. I wonder if I go back.
Under any circumstances, hurt my wife, Maggie. And I would never, under any circumstances, hurt my son, Paw Paw.
Well, and it might not have been you. It might have been the monster you become when you take 15, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60 opioid pills. Maybe you become another person. In the murder of your wife, Maggie Murdaugh, I sentence you for a term of the rest of your natural life for the murder of Paul Murdaugh, whom you probably loved so much. I sentence you to prison for murdering him for the rest of your natural life.
I respect this court.
Wow. Yeah. Another thing that came out during this trial was that Maggie had been separated from Alec for about a month now and wasn't even living there. She received a text from him to go meet him there to talk. She texted her sister and said she thought he was up to something. Her sister is the one who convinced her to go to Moselle home that night because Alex and Paul were having a hard time with his father's illness and his mother's dementia. This is the unfinished story. Continuous story of the murders and crimes committed by Alex Murdaugh and his family.
That's fucking crazy. Sounds like a movie, man.
Right? They're going to make a movie out of this.
They're going to make a movie out of this.
Yeah.
I mean, you have other pictures on here too, though. But
yeah, you can show the pictures.
But yeah, it's fucking kind of, yeah. It really does seem like a movie. You can make a movie out of it. And the names sound like they're in fucking movies, to be honest with you. I mean, hold on. I guess that's
Mallory, Anthony, Connor, and Connor's girlfriend. They were all on the boat.
Yeah.
And the girl with the burgundy dress is Mallory, who died. And Anthony, that's the one that's the girl who died. Yeah. And Anthony behind her boyfriend, that's the one who was freaking out on Paul for laughing when his girlfriend literally just fucking disappeared into the fucking water because of his reckless driving. Yeah.
Wow.
That was Mallory. Yeah. She's really pretty.
Very pretty.
Yeah. That's her and Anthony. That's Steven and Sandy.
Steven and Sandy?
Yeah. And this is the lovely Murdaugh family. There's Alec. There's Papa, Buster, Maggie.
Bow ties. That's just killing me in their armchair. Sorry. One big happy fucked up family. Wow.
Yeah.
Oh man, that is kind of sad. It's crazy, but
yeah, that's the story of it all.
So far, right? We don't know how much coming out of it.
I don't know. Buster came out a couple weeks ago asking people leave him alone because he has nothing to do with Stephen Smith's murder. bullshit. But
I thought you actually did that. I was gonna say, excuse yourself, excuse you. No. Like, I thought it was a kind of a sneeze coming up.
Whatever, you know, like, I guess innocent until proven guilty. But yeah, man. On the day that Alec was sentenced to life, as he was walking out of the courthouse, there was a heckler outside of the courthouse and said, "Today was you, but your son Buster's next." So, and he was loud and clear, man. So, I mean, like, I don't know. I wasn't there. I can't. This is all speculation. But the evidence, the circumstantial evidence is so strong. And we know that there's hardcore evidence, but because the police have admitted it, right? SLED has talked about it, but they said that they can't divulge any more information because it's an ongoing investigation, right? And the last thing they need are the internet sleuths around, right? speculating and harassing and all this stuff or whatever, right? I mean, I've listened to some of the jail tapes between Alec and Buster. It's pretty fucked up. You know, Buster was complaining to his dad that the media was all over him because he was out at the casino gambling. I mean, like, yeah, the media is going to be all over you. Your family stole millions and millions and millions of dollars from innocent humans and you're out fucking gambling? Seriously? You know, like, fuck. Like,
I guess that's what you do when you're rich, man. Rich, right? People problems.
Yeah, but man, like, they just recently sold that house out. They're selling off and auctioning off all their belongings because Alex doesn't have enough money to pay everybody, right?
Yeah, I would think so. I mean, that's a big property too, for fuck's sakes.
So they sold off that property. They've been selling the boats. They've been selling everything.
Well, there's one big money in cases like
that. And this. That's the thing. When you sell, right, a percent, like, you don't get to see that money. It goes firstly directly to who you owe it to. And if there's anything left over, then it goes to you, right?
Yeah.
But anything that they're auctioning off has to legally be auctioned off. You get what I'm saying? And then there's a phone call. See, these lawyer fucking guys who know the law so well. There's a conversation between Buster and Alec again in jail. Like, I don't think Alec is so stupid. He doesn't realize his phone calls are all being fucking, you know, recorded in jail. And Alec is telling Buster that he should sell the tractors and trailers to his brother Randy. And Buster's like, "I can't sell it. I can give it to him, but I can't sell it. I can gift it to him, but I can't sell it."
Wink, like, wink.
You know, like, can you be any more obvious on how you plan on keeping everything you own? You know,
and then, like, you know what, too, and I don't want to blame for Alec or whatever. I don't want to put like blame on the opioid addiction, but it does really mess with your concentration in your head and your way of thinking too if you're really addicted. So I mean, maybe he was smart at one point in concealing things, but eventually because of the addiction, it fucking overpowered
him. Fucks with your brain, man. It all overpowers.
Yeah, it doesn't make you. Unless you can get off it, you're not physically the same, mentally the same person a lot of the times, right?
No.
Because you're all sketched out and tripped out and fucking, you know.
Yeah, pretty much.
They'll do just about anything to protect themselves when they're on fucking drugs, you know.
Pretty much.
So, that's fucking crazy. I'm not just trying to justify it by any means, but I'm just saying, you know, it does not help with common sense.
No.
But apparently this wasn't there before. This wasn't, you know, the common sense was long way before the opioid crisis.
Yeah, I think that this family just for so long got away with doing murder? So much. I mean, like, this kind of behavior doesn't just come from Alec. It comes from his great, great grandfather. Right.
Yeah.
Like,
but back then it was a different fucking time.
But they were still corrupt. Do you get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So like,
it was just harder to put them away.
Right. So, I mean, like, the night that, that boating accident happened, Randy and Alec showed up right away, right, to the hospital, not to see how his son was doing, but to go personally, individually to each one of those kids and tell them, look, it wasn't Paul driving, okay? It was Connor. Like, how the fuck can you fucking put blame like that on someone completely different? Like, without any fucking remorse. Dude, this isn't the fucking graffiti. Someone wrote graffiti on the fucking wall. Let's go blame the other guy, right? No, this was a fucking death. You know, like, the fact that this family thought they were so above everybody that they could even try to convince other people to say this. Oh, and the night that Stephen was found, Randy and Alec were in the crime scene taking pictures of everything.
Well, there's pictures.
They had to get kicked out of that crime scene before Stephen's parents even knew that Stephen was dead. They were already taking pictures of that crime scene.
The cleaner. The one that comes to clean up the mess.
Yeah, man.
It's fucked up, man.
Yeah, they are fucked up. So yeah, that's the story.
It's pretty sad that they can't get their story straight. Like, you would think, you know, maybe a little bit more, you would like to say smarter in a sense, because probably gone to better schools and shit and this and that. So you would think that they, and you know, it would be a lot easier for them to talk on the phone, especially when they're under pressure, or who knows. Like, I mean, but it just shows you that if you're under pressure, you don't necessarily consider everything you're saying, right? So, and it really, I mean, those confessions alone right there stood out big time. If I was a juror, I mean, just listening to those tapes would fucking already sway my opinion to say that there's some sort of something's not right.
Anyhow,
I wouldn't be able to say without a reasonable cause, right?
Right. But that's it, right? It's like circumstantial evidence, but it's so strong that it's like it's all circumstantial except the actual Maggie and Paul's murders. Where Alex was convicted and sentenced to life, right? I mean, like, there was proof that the guy did it, right? But the rest of it is so circumstantial without it being like...
Well, there being evidence.
It's still evidence. It's just circumstantial evidence, right?
Like physical evidence.
Right? Because and now the fact that it took... Like, Stephen's death investigation wasn't open until they started investigating Maggie and Paul's. And then they found something and reopened the investigation into Stephen's death. So they said they found something linking the Murdaugh family to Stephen Smith. And to Stephen Smith. And then that's how they reopened Stephen Smith's investigation.
Yeah.
And they've officially called it a homicide. It's no longer hit and run. So they know that he was murdered. It wasn't a car. Like, this was, And now I'm really curious as to see what this new autopsy will lead to. Right. I mean, like, it may be a couple years before we know everything that the cops know. Who knows how long this investigation is going to last, but at least it's being thoroughly investigated now. And bless that mother, because it was the fact that she couldn't keep her mouth shut and kept advocating for her child that this is even happening right now, that this guy, this poor kid may find, like, his family may finally seek justice to whoever did this, right? But yeah.
Crazy. Crazy. That's another great episode, Leslie.
Thanks. I hope you enjoyed it. Now you can go watch the documentary.
Now I'm going to compare the notes, right? No.
Go compare the notes. Yeah.
I'll come back with some facts. No. that was another great one. Can't wait to see what's up next, guys.
Yeah. And, guys, I would suggest that everybody watch that documentary. It's pretty good. The HBO one, to me, is a little bit better. But like I said, they're both incomplete because they both do not show Alec Murdaugh's trial, because it literally just ended.
Just happened. Yeah.
Just happened. So, I mean, yeah.
Yeah, no, I remember seeing that too much, not just recently, so much in the news. That's why, like a little while back. So, but yeah, thanks again, Leslie, guys.
Thank you.
And, thanks for everybody that is watching. And like I said, make sure to keep posted the late night chat network for updates on the next killer content, and you know, watch us here live every week. So alrighty, we will see you soon. You want me to play the rest of that one after, or what?
Just yeah, sure, go play it.
All right, here you go.
Good night, guys. With the soul stuff, I bring beef to a closure. No sum from Capsacky to Folsom. I'm loathsome. I scream out, fuck the world, and I throw some. Niggas scheming hard, but fuck it, it's the guard. I leave bullets large, leave you leaning on your broad. The R pump, leave you fucked up in your car slumped. Kennedy style with your memory out. The fuck y'all want? Daddy O with the Cali cold. Let the gaddy blow. Leave you bleeding on your patio. I leave rivals on their back looking up at the sky blue. Not only do I leave you, I hide you. I before you. X and Ja Rule. Death before dishonor. Now and prior to. Boss man, fire you. Expire you. Me die before you. Lying you, niggas is dead off the hits I approve. Shit, I got the feds wearing riot suits. Y'all niggas don't listen, but the streets are in prison. When we find them, we twist them. Niggas waking up missing.